Hello and welcome to the first video for Web Art and Design. That's going to be the lecture for this class. So this lecture is called The Environment and the Tools. So much fun, but what is it? So I want to start off talking a little bit about the environment. And first of all, oftentimes people talk about the internet and the web as being the same thing. So I'm not going to go too much into the history here. I just want to throw out a few terms and sort of start us off with our feet on the ground in terms of this medium that we're working in. So what is the internet? The internet is actually a network of networks. It's a series of computers that are connected to each other. So some examples of internet versus the web are your email and FTP, which is file transfer protocol. So a system that is set up for transferring files, perhaps from one computer to another, instant messaging, or apps on your phone. So this is all the internet. These are standardized methods for transferring data or documents over a network are known as protocols. So that's a term that we're going to hear a whole bunch of times, protocols. So briefly, just a couple points from history here. And I'm going to add a whole bunch of other links on Blackboard for you to be able to go into this history and to some of the names that I'm going to talk about a little bit more on your own. But the birth of the internet came from the U.S. Department of Defense, and they founded the Advanced Research Project Agency, known as ARPA. This was in the 60s. And so really what the first internet was a bunch of computers that were in major universities that were connected. And the first people using this system were mostly university professors and researchers. And they were using this system, the internet, to be able to share information. And I bring that up because something that will come up when we get into the net artist is how the birth of the internet started out with free information sharing. And that's not exactly the situation that we have anymore. So it was originally funded by the U.S. Department of Defense. And it was a connection of computers set up between major universities, Stanford University, MIT. And it was used for sharing information. The web, on the other hand, let's talk a little bit about that environment, uses one of these protocols. I remember going back a couple of slides, I mentioned the term protocol. So it uses the HTTP protocol. And that's just one of the many languages that can be transmitted over the internet. The World Wide Web uses browsers for transmitting the data over the internet. So just very briefly, let's go into a little bit of history. So I've put up some links on Blackboard about Vannevar Bush and the Memex. It's kind of hard to talk about anything related to the web without talking about the Memex. So in 1945, Vannevar Bush was an army scientist, and he was asked to write an article in the Atlantic Monthly that would tell the world that technology could be used for something positive. This is 1945, we've just had the atomic bomb, and, you know, frankly, technology is kind of associated with death and rather negative. So he writes this article where he's predicting how technology can really be positive for the future. And it's in this article he writes about, and he kind of creates in his head and predicts this machine called the Memex. So this machine was never built, it's just something that he wrote about. But this machine essentially is a prediction of the World Wide Web. So it's this kind of computer system or a desk that you sit down at, and you can, the idea is that you can be a researcher and you go out in the field and you have a camera, which is microfilm, attached to your head, let's say, and so your hands are free for taking notes, and you're going and you're taking pictures of whatever it is that you're researching. And you come back and you sit down at your desk, the Memex, and you can take that microfilm and you put it into one of these drawers that's going to fall up, that's going to come out, and it's going to come up on the screens that you see here, and you can add your notes. And then what's really cool about this is it's the first device or the first time anyone have ever thought about leaving a trail of notes and making that connection between your notes associative. So right now, at this point, indexing had only been through categories or through alphabetizing. We didn't have any kind of indexing that was through association. So what he's saying is an electronic type of device that can essentially create a trail of your thoughts and allow you to make these notes, but to keep this trail through association. So let's say you're doing research on a bird, and then that's your main research, but then you happen to be also talking about the type of tree that the bird is on. So you could then make a little trail, make some notes, and connect in your notes about the bird research to some other articles that were written about those particular types of trees. On Blackboard, I have a link to a YouTube video that was put together as a little animation of what the mimics would do. So please go and check that out just so you can see this couple minute live demo of, if the mimics had ever been created, what it would actually do. So this is kind of a cool device. 1945, Vannevar Bush writes about it, never is actually created. But what he did was he inspired all of these thinkers after him, these computer scientists, to start developing the system. So there are a million names involved here, really starting around the 1960s, of people who will get involved in making the different parts to the computer and to the internet. Just one name that I'm going to throw out there is Ted Nelson. And actually, I'm throwing him out there because he's a little bit a thorn in the side of the history of the internet and the World Wide Web. And I have some links up on Blackboard, and I'd like you to go and to watch his video. Ted Nelson developed the term, was credited with creating the term hypertext, also intertwingled, a term that we don't really use that much. But he said everything is deeply intertwingled. And as you'll see when you watch the video, he developed a system called Xanadu. And it's a word processor, but it's also kind of a browser. And it's really an alternative to the type of web browsers that we have now. So I'd like you to watch it because I think he brings up a couple of good points, which is that we, first of all, we think that we understand the best way that browsers should work. And but what he says is that really what we've developed in terms of not just browsers, but word processing, it just imitates paper. And we're not fully taking advantage of all the electronic means that we could be once we're dealing with a computer. So, you know, it's something just kind of interesting to think about is, could there be a whole other way that computers could be functioning than the way that the history that we have with them and the way that they have developed? So his system, Xanadu, and you can research that a little bit, is an alternative word processor and browser that allows you to create your own kind of trail. So that's hypertext. He was inspired by Vannevar Bush, the concept of associative trails, and he coined the term hypertext and made actual hypertext, so you could be able to click on something and to be able to get to another document that had that same kind of reference. And then, of course, the person, we have to just mention this name, Tim Berners-Lee, who actually did develop the World Wide Web as we know it now. So that's he first proposed that in 1989. I just think it's a good number to know, just kind of like how long this has been around. And between 1989 and 1991, he worked with his team at CERN, and that's where they developed the World Wide Web. So it was something that developed over a couple of years. And, you know, the original versions of the web couldn't take images. They were all just really for that free information of data, research, transmission. So I also have a link up there on Blackboard for a little bit of information about him. So still just talking about that environment and how does that work. So how do web servers work? Well, I just want to mention this because I think sometimes people think that web servers are very magical. And actually, a web server can be just kind of a high-end computer. It's really, the trick is the software that's on the web server. So web servers, those computers are part of the internet, and they have this particular server software on them. And the role of the server is to wait for information. So I'm going to just jump ahead here. So domain names and IP addresses. So the server is there waiting for information. And every one of these computers that is on the internet has an IP address. But if we wanted to come to a particular website and we had to type an IP address such as 208.201.239.37, we're never going to remember these things. So that's why the DNS, the domain name system, was developed. So basically the domain name system translates for the server the domain name into the IP address. And I have a link also up on Blackboard about that. So I'd like you to just read a little bit more on that. It's kind of an interesting little history. So going back to the servers, if the servers are doing the serving, who's asking the question? And then by this point, it might be obvious, but who's asking the question are the browsers. The browsers ask the questions. Those are the clients. Web page addresses. So let's talk a little bit about this. With all those web pages on the servers, how would you ever find the one that you're looking for? Well, that's why we have URLs, Uniform Resource Locator. So I really want to talk about this because I want you to understand what your URL is. Most of the time, the way you're going to be submitting your projects to me is you're going to make them live. You're going to put them on your U drive. And once they're on your U drive, we can access them through your own URL. So your URL is the address hvcc.edu/your user ID. To get anything to show up at that URL, you're going to put them into your U drive. So for you, you should understand that everything that is in your U drive is public. Anyone else can see it, so don't put anything private in there. All right, so let's talk about then the parts of the URL. So the first part of the URL is to define the protocol. So the letters HTTP let the server know that it's using the hypertext transfer protocol, which basically means get into web mode. When you are accessing your URL, you do not need to put in the HTTP. In fact, browsers are programmed to already do that automatically. So when you write in the URL for most places, you don't put in the HTTP. But I just want to make sure when you understand that, that when you're uploading or you're typing into the web browser your own URL, you don't need to put that. And you also don't need to put the www. So the next portion of the URL identifies the website by its domain name. So as you can see here in this example, the domain name is gendesign.com. So the www part at the beginning of a particular host name has become a convention, but it is not a rule. So in fact, many times you can omit the www. And again, when you're typing yours in, do not put the www. It won't work. And so the next part and the last thing that I want to talk about here is the path. And this is going to be kind of important. So we started off with the protocol, then we go to the domain name, then it's the path. So let's say you want to show me a particular web page that is in a folder that is in another folder. So it's kind of like the example that we have here. So we would have, imagine there's a folder that says 2007, then there's another folder inside of 2007 that says samples. And inside that, that's where the HTML page is that is first.html. So let's imagine that you've put your folders, and that's what you're going to do. When your first projects are just going to be simple single pages. So it's just a simple it's just a single page. But for your, those are your homework assignments. But later on for your actual projects, you're going to save them all in a folder, and that's going to be called your root folder, and you're going to copy that whole root folder and put it in your U drive. So let's say you call your root folder Project 1, and in Project 1 is where you have your HTML file. So here you can see an example. If this was going to be in my URL, it would be hvcc.edu/my user ID, Project 1, and the spelling has to be exactly the same as that actual folder is, slash, and then the name, the exact same spelling, .html of that file. Okay, and there's another example there. So the convention for, and we'll talk about this more later, but just want to point out this example why my second example says index.html. So the convention is, how does a web browser know which page, if I just want to go directly into my domain name, and I just want them to type the domain name, and then the first page comes up, how does the browser know? The browser looks for an index.html or HTM, which I'll explain more about later, but an index page, and that's how it knows that's the first page. And all the linking and everything after there is up to you. Okay, so what I want you to do for just after watching this is I'd like you to do a little bit more research on all of the people that I mentioned from those links on Blackboard. And the second thing is just go and check out your own URL. So open up a browser, type in hvcc.edu/your user ID. And you should see something that says root directory, and it shouldn't have anything in it unless you've used it for another class. If you get an error message, double check that you actually typed it incorrectly, hvcc.edu/your user ID. And if there's a problem with it, then you can go to, contact me, and I'll send you, you're going to go to the library, lower level, and talk to at the help desk, and just check to see if there's something wrong with your user profile. Okay, so I'll see you at the next video.